serialized.
In a background, it's serialized, yeah.
In which you kind of expect it to list.
But it doesn't do that.
No, not only with floppies, with fast file system. Nothing else does that.
There's no support for doing that same thing in any other.
No. There you go, right?
How do we fix that?
Yeah, where do we fix that?
Yeah, well, they don't want to fix it.
I want to fix it.
Oh, okay. Well, you could start a debate.
Yes, I work with multiple drives. I have my hot swap.
Yes.
And I just punch in one or the other in different test drives. Yeah. And there's some cases where you want to get something off of the other one. Yeah. You got two volumes exactly the same name.
Yes.
Because they're close to each other. Yeah.
That's a common problem. I thought they were discussing this before, and they thought monitor library should be the one assigning a serial number to each one unique serial number.
That would make sense.
Right? Yeah. But not everything's using monitor library, yes. I'm working.
What is using monitor library now?
That's a good
question. My drivers and the USB stick. Yep.
So nothing else is. Well, when was monitor library introduced?
Before when?
So recent.
Yeah, recent. Very recent.
Okay. No, so wasn't it? There was a monitor much earlier.
It's a mounter.
A mounter?
Mounter, but not mounter library.
Yeah, not mounter.
So now, for device handling, mounter library is the guy you go to.
Yeah.
To get your...
Because otherwise, if you're ready to track this device, you have to do your own mounting.
Well, see, so you have a track this device,
yeah.
And the guy that's going to set that up is going to be mounted, right?
They just launch it at one.
Well, no, but I mean, the guy, so the launch point for installing the TrackDIS device itself, to load it for a start. I mean, the SATA stuff is in the kernel module. It's got to happen, really.
Yes.
But for a later one, where that's not so critical.
Oh, okay.
You know, so it's like added a hard drive.
Like disk image device.
Well, think, yeah, like, or you think the old school terms, where you had a brand new hard drive, you got your mount disk entry,
you put all this stuff in there.
It's mount. Launch from the startup sequence, gather up all the drives in the active folder. That's still the entry. That's still the guy that does the load say of the device.
Yep. Loads it, initializes it. That's it.
And then, but at that point, isn't it DOS with open or half open that really kicks off the whole?
Well, you have to tell DOS it's there, but to tell DOS it's there, you have to scan it. DOS expects it to be scanned, and there's where your mounter kicks in. You have to scan it being the track distance. You have to go through that hard drive and look at it and say, oh, it's got a fast file system partition.
Mounter library does that task as well.
But in the past it never did anything.
Right. But
you have to copy that code for each device being a device.
But as you mount devices now into the new system,
how
is that being done?
Well, through monitor library now.
Well, your SATA controller jumps in early, uses monitor library, does a scan. So that's all the SATA stuff is set up.
Yeah.
USB also knows to use it, so the USB attachment set up.
Yeah.
But if you had a totally new controller, NVMe
device,
and you made it look like a TrackDIS device, what are the steps needed to get it into the system and available?
Yeah, you'd have to call them.
So that would be the way to do it.
Yeah, absolutely.
So
there's an announce, it's called. Okay, I announce a new device is present on my port.
But that brings you back to the guy that owns it and didn't get registered and stuff, right?
Well, then an Octopus gets registered. It's running. It's nothing to do with mount command.
I don't know what's changed.
It's not a manual mount. So you have a background mount task. And how is it? Somewhere you've got to add to the list, basically.
Well, after you've done scanning, then you know what to add to the list. You can tell DOS.
Yeah, that's it.
Then
I'm still trying to figure out the from scratch, the bootstrapping.
Yeah.
You know, how does it? You've added it to the system. How does it? You're adding a track disk device dynamically to the system.
Oh, that's through the resolution. Right? But that's, there's another step, the kernel is for it. It loads all the disk drivers, all the KMODs, kernel modules, right?
Yeah. So I mean, the Kickstart load will take care of that because you're picking up all your
costs. Yes. So launches them in the priority order.
So can you still do track disk devices dynamically, you know, after Kickstart?
Oh yeah, just the normal way. Just call them up.
Yeah. Right. So that's what I said. Getting back to the guy that has to load it in to begin with.
Yeah, it's the same. No different.
So Mount would load it. Mm-hmm. But is Mount smart enough to announce it?
No. Mount knows nothing. All it knows is load and execute.
Can we upgrade Mount to be able to use Mount?
That's the point.
Well, I'm still trying to figure out how you get it to announce it, though.
Well, my driver calls it out.
Well, now it's your back to the resident, right? So you auto it into the resident, and then it, For some reason, I really lost it again, because it's like, how does it get there? How does it know? Somebody's got to run it somewhere.
Yeah.
You do, because you set it up as a resident object, and you auto it in, it jumps in, and it set up helps, and now you
That's the way
you
do it now.
That's
not just saying it's the best system, but
it's serious.
It's something. But the other way would be kind of like your thing is make Mount smarter, so okay, it loads
smarter.
It initializes it, and then it sends its first command that says announce your devices,
right,
or something. Mm-hmm. It would do a special new command,
and it would have to do it to the device driver
because the device driver is the only guy who knows.
Yeah.
What exists on those ports.
Yeah, volumes or some logical space.
Otherwise,
data.
We'd have to add another API that goes, okay, do you have anything in port 0?
You need the right.
Yes, okay, announce. Do you have anything in port 1?
Oh,
yes.
Yeah.
We'd have to do it. We have to do that step somewhere. Which software module does it?
But you can get it done by using mount and a resident tag
For
auto it in. Send it out, do the announce. Now it's in there. Use mount. Now DOSky's in here.
It's quite a few steps.
Yeah. So figure out. So at that point then, the file system, it's DOS. That's the file system. The actual messages to the practice device. Right.
Yeah.
They're coming from the file system. Later, aren't they?
Yeah, later, after mounter.
After it's all set up and everything, the actual reads and writes, the daily stuff, it's
the
all
system.
Coming from the file system.
Yeah, and the file system runs out of DOS too.
Yeah,
it's a task.
The file system is the one that's deciding how the data is supposed to be logically run.
Yeah, it figures out all the
and
blocks,
so it sends
chunks.
Reads and writes of block chunks, and you say, there's five for all, there's a day, there's 10 meg.
That's a scary thing. You get a read request for 10 megs of data. Just one request.
Yeah.
Just give me 10 megs.
Tell you.
Okay. Here it comes. I was surprised. I get these gigantic requests for giant chunks. I'm like, are you sure?
No. Data is big.
Yeah.
I don't
know if you heard. Yeah, it's kind of scary.
Well, they're trying to cash it too. They're trying to bring it out.
All sorts of tricks to try and get performance out of it. It's all about performance. Usual stuff.
Blue bypass. I'm going to take a break from that right over here. File system, it's just a raw block. It's just
bad. Any other questions? Anyone? Do you want to do one more thing, or should we call it a day?
Not for me. I got
to get back. Oh yes, I thought. Well, we could do one more presentation.
Well, yeah. Well, we got other
possibilities.
I
thought. Well, you
can try to
slip
in. Mark's got some stuff he wanted to.
I think you'd need more time, though. Yeah. I thought you'd be pretty quick.
It should be fairly quick,
Like an hour at most?
Not even, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You Just give an update on
that. Just update on
that. Yeah, it's sort of, I mean, it's basically the
a rundown of how the project's gone so far.
You need the computer? Or
yeah, I've got a PDF.
Okay, well, can you use your computer again, or should I swap it for this one?
I can swap. Well, if you can swap it, I appreciate it, because I got all the light code on there and I need to write from there. I got to get it over into the machine yet.
He's got the itch.
I want to show it.
Handwave and dance.
Oh, okay. I can do it. He's talking for
it. Well, that's it.
Maybe I should have run this off the USB cable.
That's okay, it's not.
So, basically, the project started with the Tabor motherboard came out for 8, 12, 22. I've always wanted to have a portable laptop, I'm not the only one. Kind of like getting stuff. The question was, how could I power it? First step of the process was really feasibility analysis. I didn't want a laptop that would run a few minutes on battery and then die. It's really, you know, a few hours at least.
Yeah.
Had a quick look. Airlines will allow you to have up to 100 watt hours of battery in your laptop. So, if you can keep the in testing, I assume if I can keep it below 50 watts, then I'll get a few hours out of it. Found a small UPS. In testing, the Tabor, and this is without power management, so 25 to 30 watts, I think, was what we averaged. So yeah, doable. Waiting for the next slide. Next thing was the display. That one got kind of messy. I discovered there are a lot of very low quality LCD controls out there. I had one, I got it, one of the components fell off the wall.
That love it.
No, eventually I did find a good one, which is the one that I'm using right now. Literally fell off. And others, though, I assume that they would read what the LCD panel would do, because it's display port, right? So I assume they would read what the LCD's capabilities were and adapt to it. No, most of them, the screen modes and everything are hard-coded into the controller. Well, not hard-coded, they're in an EEPROM somewhere, and the manufacturer really doesn't want to tell you how to change it. Yeah. Next thing, I go through the layout test. I've got all the components, put them on the table. That's small enough. That'll do. Compared to my Windows laptop, probably the same size, two-dimensionally. The 3D, we're going to be pretty fat because the backplate of a mini ICS board is already like that. Next step, this is what I showed last year. At Amiwest last year was a full-on test. Created my battery holder, a simple panel with the power underneath. At that point, I thought, this Amiwest 2018, I'll have my laptop completed. But didn't quite realize the challenges I'd set myself up for. So current situations, I'm still working on the prototyping. Found in some situations you've got too many options, like which switches you can choose and everything else. But in other situations, I thought you should be able to buy a USB keyboard that's ultra thin with a trackpad. No, there's basically one or two keyboards with a trackpad that are USB on the market, and that's it. So I've just accepted, well, it's going to be a fat laptop anyway. An extra centimeter doesn't make much of a difference. Next big difficulty was the 3D printer. And if you've been following the project, then you'll know I sort of complained about that a little. Basically, it was a pain to assemble. It does work, it does have its fiddly bits. But in the end, it's not accurate enough. Particularly, I want something that I can hand over to a manufacturer to make. I can get a laser cutting service or whatever, or a sheet metal shop to make it. And to get the holes the right size in the 3D printer, you have to adjust the size because the plastic squeezes out around the size a little bit more. So yeah, in the end, I've used it for a few things. I've ditched it and moved on to, particularly as it was coming close, like a few months ago, I realized that it's a bit too late to start talking to manufacturers for lead time and stuff. I need to drop down to something that I can build with my own hands, with tools borrowed from my dad and whatever else I can get my hands on. So that comes to, I now have the laptop screen, so the laptop lid. It's down the back there if you want to look at it. I had to redesign that twice. First time, the goal was to create the base in sheet metal and just create a plastic shell around it. Then I realized, well, too late to find a sheet metal company. The one I talked to was kind of, well, we've changed business models, we don't do that kind of stuff anymore. So then I thought, okay, I'll do vacuum forming. It's actually pretty easy to create a vacuum forming machine. It's just a plate with holes on it, stick a vacuum cleaner in, then you heat up the plastic, put it over a mold and suck it down. I got almost done with that, and then I discovered the plastic I want to use, I can't get in sheets big enough to actually do that. So I was okay. Redesign number two. Let's drop down to laser cut plastic and just gluing it together, which is what I finally had success with. I need to wait for this thing to show the next slide again. So that's what it looks like now. I'm glad that everything worked pretty much the first time. I think that might be down to me being quite careful and double checking everything. Even there's the LCD controller, which is a little keypad, the power button and the other things. I'm quite glad that the self-made buttons work. I wasn't sure how much the plastic would flex and all that, but it's looking like I said. What's up next? First thing, I want to improve the screen a little bit, make it a little bit lighter. The hinges, it's quite surprising, if you hold the hinges by themselves, you can't rotate it by hand. But as soon as you actually connect it to something, that LCD screen is just a little bit too heavy, so it tilts it down to about here and then it flops down. It can't hold it. Which is no big deal, but it'd be nice to make it a bit lighter. I'm hoping to find some thinner material for the screen, for the outer skin, sorry. And that's because some of it's bent plastic, and bending plastic is a bit of a pain. You gotta heat it to the right temperature, heat it too much, it'll start bubbling and warping. Don't heat it enough and it'll snatch. So having thinner plastic would be nicer, and I'm thinking maybe I created the outer frame around the sides just by gluing laser cut plastic together layer by layer, and I found that really tedious, so maybe I'll use it in printing that there. And then after that, it's designing the base. I think I'll do that in two stages. First, you're just having a bent panel for mounting the electronics. So, plug the old desk and it's working. And then after that, I'll go for the outer case. And I'll probably use the same techniques that I've used for the screen, because I know they work. Initially, after all the trouble like that. To tie this back into software a little bit, there are a few things that, once you've got a portable battery powered machine that open up, things that we'd like to have. So opportunities for software developers. We'd really like a USB driver for the UPS. So it's a standard protocol. And the reason for that is, it'd be nice to switch to a lower power mode if you're on the battery, and to know when to shut the machine down, so you don't lose work. And the other thing is, of course, we'd like to have actual power management for other devices, particularly the CPU. And just a quick note, they have a rating on Rx, but the large cards does actually have better combination built in. You can't switch the path profile yet. There's no point in implementing that until we've got the ability to do it. But it will drop to a low power mode when it's running idly or running stuff that is pretty low power. So beyond that, it'd be nice to have some XP Wi-Fi. I'm using a little miniature travel router that actually wants to connect to the hotel's network. But it'd be nice to have, this little USB dongle's around that big versus a block that big, so it'd be nice to have that. And then beyond that, I reckon once you've got a shell, classic mega people will be placed, stick one of their boards in. And
Trevor's not here.
It would be nice to have a compact motherboard that has a graphics card built in, because once you've got that, then you can squeeze the size down even further. I mean, I'm fine with having a fat portable laptop machine. But at the same time, you just maybe look ahead in a few years, it'd be nice to switch it down a bit. So that's where I am now. obviously, most people here are more software engineers than mechanical. But if you've got any suggestions, maybe where I can find materials, other ways to start things, I'd be happy to hear from you. And at the same time, if you've got any questions,
thought about maybe doing a Kickstarter or that kind of thing, crowdsourcing in different cases. I mean, professionally, so to speak.
I have thought about it a little bit.
Injection
budget. Yeah, because there's a couple classic cases that came up.
I have thought about it a bit. I do need to get built first, though. Right. And the way what I think at the moment, injection mold cases are going to happen. As we're talking about, $10,000 plus per mold. And to make a full shell, you need multiple molds. So you would need quite a number of people to catch in for that.
I think you did it. If you had a viable motherboard to put in there, if I had a choice, I know you'd get it. I've done two of those Kickstarters myself.
Okay.
Four cases for the 1200, four cases for the 500.
Yeah, okay.
I'd be on it absolutely.
That might be possibility.
The guys you work with would be Phil at 800.net. When you get to that stage, talk to him because he's had all the connections and produce it.
Okay.
That's what I was thinking. Especially if you let somehow put in a little bit of room for classic guys to slip their board.
That's right.
Yeah.
Somehow, like, I don't know,
it's a laptop.
Well, it should be possible. I mean, the mini ITX spec is like that high.
Yeah.
I'm actually planning on compiling the spec a little bit because they say the components will have to go up to 56 millimeters above the board or something like that. But that's for people with high powered CPUs using bulky heat sinks. The UPS can deliver 100 watts, but if you go over that, you don't have a power source anymore. So nobody's going to be putting those kind of motherboards in there anyway. So I'm going to trim it down a little bit to the, it's still going to be above the edge of the backplate there. But with that,
all
the classic guys in
those spaces. Classic, you got all the retro computing guys in your Raspberry Pi base builds on system for emulation. I'd love to be able to look at your screen like that.
Once you
figured out the power,
you're
figuring out the screen,
the electronics,
the mechanics,
really
it's an easy one.
And you need to add the kickler up to
the case itself, then you get the different ports and stuff. You're going with your motherboard, you can find different options for that. And you can do the same thing with the other module swap out pieces for some of the backplates.
Cost is very minimal.
It's getting the molds produced.
To do the Kickstarter in case it failed or Indiegogo.
If
they fail, you lose a couple $100 or something. The risk is minimal.
The risk is very minimal.
If it fails, although.
Yeah.
Have you costed out the production run initial outlay?
No, too many variables right now.
So we're getting tabs.
Yeah. I mean, for me, it's a very expensive laptop. Well, I've been buying components and then those components can't be used. Like those crappy LCD controllers.
Do we have DPMS support at all in the operating system?
Yes.
We do? Okay.
Yes, we do.
Okay.
I mean, we don't need it with the LCD. The LCD controller's got its own brightness controller. But theoretically, you could drive it via software as well. I'm not sure our reference library's up for that yet, but
well, I was thinking of tying it to input on device.
Input device. Yeah, that's good stuff. The DPMS is already in there. It'd be nice to get more power management.
That'd have to be a little module.
Yeah, so yeah, it would be. It's complicated.
What would it talk to, power manager? Like, what's it, is there
the biggest thing is stuff like the CPU can be powered down to a lower clock speed.
Oh, you just need an API to access the CPU throttle.
That system needs to be there.
SOC to
I mean, it goes beyond that because there are more, you can make it more complicated than that because PCI Express standard, you can drop the PCI Express bus to a lower power level as well. Like I say, well, we only need a 1x link right now. So let's ditch the others.
You can get more aggressive with the power down on your desk.
Yeah. And then when you can detect if it's on battery power, which is why I want the UPS driver. Then when it's on battery power, then you can say, okay, let's dim the screen, let's cut things down to a lower, like a different power profile. Well, I spotted that in AMD's Linux driver, that they have a battery power profile. It just means that...
And how do you know it's on battery?
The UPS tells you. You plug the UPS into the machine by USB.
Oh, and then USB.
By USB, okay. And then it...
But there's something missing.
Years ago, I had some people who wanted to do a portable thing, and what they did is they took a briefcase, and essentially the briefcase was, almost the size of this thing.
Yeah.
But it was wider because the briefcase is made for legal paper and stuff, and they basically just took the other stuff out and then put the stuff in.
Yeah.
And they put the monitor on the lid part, and that was about the same width. So you open your briefcase and you have this thing right there.
Yeah.
So I know you want to get thin and small because that's what we have nowadays, but wouldn't a briefcase be kind of nice?
I didn't like that idea.
Okay.
I didn't think
that's popular.
I wanted to have a proper case where I can access the back walls. As opposed to just jamming the components into a briefcase.
Well, a briefcase.
It's not a bad idea.
Most briefcases are made essentially a little box is made and then leather's put over the top.
Right.
There's no reason that you couldn't make the little leather, the little box, and then leave holes and stuff for
cut holes out.
Yeah. And then, because it's wood normally, and then just cover the size of the bottom and top, and even the back with a little. Finish the full leather. It wouldn't be that expensive. Then.
Yeah.
It would all still look.
It'd look like a briefcase.
It would look like a briefcase, but that's not a bad look. I mean, you carry briefcases all the time.
Yeah, it wouldn't be that RFID product. You'd have
potential
RFID.
Well, instead of then you could shield the wood with a little thin sheet or something.
Which is why I originally wanted to use sheet metal. Box. I might still do that.
How about a sheet metal briefcase?
Sheet metal briefcase.
That would be thinner because the sheet metal itself would be thin. You wouldn't have all the padding in a suitcase.
Yeah, that's true.
But it would still be the same box.
Yeah.
It could open up very much like the typical box.
Yeah.
Laptop. Somebody did it real successfully back in the 64 days, they put a whole thing in there. Another person took a compact and did that.
It did the same thing.
Yeah.
Right.
A lot of do-it-yourselfers in my youth.
Yeah,
just an idea.
Yeah, it's an idea.
Not a good one.
Any questions? No?
Okay. At one space it.
Sorry?
At one space it. You're ready.
Put a
set it out.
I had to look at what else was available and discovered they're now moving away from standards to the one thing. Because then I looked at, well, you need to adapt that to a SATA, but as soon as you get a SATA adapter for them, they're the same size as the 2.5-inch disc. So you haven't won anything. Okay. I'll have to check that out.
How much did they run?
$64, $16
was. But even more.
That's the Discman module?
For SATA. They make SATA, IDE for AIDS as well. Actually, Aaron's got the other one.
Yeah.
No, they do make SATA.
I've only seen Discman modules on IDE for classes. I've never seen them for.
Yeah, very tiny. No, neither have I at this point, but apparently they have SATA.
They're probably less power.
Yeah, less power.
Which makes perfect sense, probably, to SATA version, because you have more plus.
Yeah.
Instead of the IDE Discman modules. And the nice thing with the Discman modules too is that they were industrial. You know, they are meant to be hard drives.
Yeah.
For a long, long, long time.
Yeah. They probably have a decent controller.
Anything else, or shall we wrap it up?
Will these be available to us for a new proposal, or is it still private?
What? Like
slide deck.
Slide deck?
No, you can.
Yeah. It's fine.
Going on a sales trip.
Mm-hmm. You're going to leak it.
Oh!
Yeah!
In the excitement building.
No, unfortunately, I missed part of the presentation.
Okay.
Of course, teasing Trevor, what are the chances of actually getting a smaller board?
Smaller one. See, the biggest challenge we have with the Amiga right now is to really make it thin, you need the graphics card to be on board. And getting the graphics chip put on the board and maintaining supply of that for more than, I don't know how many months, is a bit of a challenge. Yeah, that's why we've always, just stuck with plug-in graphics cards.
Yeah, so you'd have to pre-purchase a big batch
and
store it.
But I could be wrong on this. I don't know how much trouble AQ had with the original set before. Because that was the only time they had a radio chip on the
phone. That's what we do for people.
Thank you.
Bill, he wants to go to keep around.
So you got the USB was for an LCD controller. You have a video chip on the SoC for the 8.2.
Yeah, but its capabilities.
How many you even
the many needs to
set?
There's no way you're going to get 12 gigabytes on that.
Chat for runner.
Put an RX chip on there.
Corrupted it to begin
with? What about from the drive chip?
It's a long story, but basically what happened was I wanted to test out the new
thing. No, because the 440 is a regular 8.9. So it's the mobility version of the one of the nine battle series. We're fine with the driver. So driver wise, it doesn't make a big difference.
It's just finding the right chip.
It's finding a chip you can get your hands on and contain supply of.
And the thing is that you have now is supposed to be one you'll have 3 months from now. Even if you, and there's that, as part of the Kickstarter, it would, can you really tell people, we're going to buy a supply of chips, and that's part of the cost here.
Yeah. So, I mean, there is the mini ITX thin standard, which says maximum 20 millimeters for everything.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're plugging in a graphics card, then the riser's going to stick up above that level anyway. So you're not winning that much. That's why the graphics chip really needs to be on top of it.
And you're going to call it Denise?
Denise?
Or Alice?
No, it was Porsche. Yeah.
Porsche.
Oh,
that's
your joke
idea. Just make sure the graphics get done.
That's
tradition.
No more questions, then we can just call it a day.
When will we be ready?
next week.
When can I do it?
Saturday? Would have the prototype ready for this show. But that was my thought a year ago. And then I started encountering all the trouble that I had.
Oh, we could buy it Saturday.
Can you let me know when that thing's off?
Are you telling me to turn it off?
Yeah, we're done for the day, right?
Are we done?
Williams?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Camera off?